and the name of the session is Data Analysis Workshop that will happen in every week on Monday from 2 p.m. to 4 p.m. inshallah. So basically, Dr. Waseem Haider will be leading this session, who is serving as assistant professor at the University of at the Comsys University in the Department of Biosciences, and he is serving since 2005 at Comsys University, Islamabad. Dr. Waseem Haider has completed his doctorate degree from University of Illinois at Urbana, USA, and now he is teaching at Comsys University and also leading different kinds of workshop related to bioinformatics and computational biology and bioinformatics field. So today we will start from the first session, inshallah, first class. And the work also includes some kind of charity.
Are you changing your slides?
Yes, sir. Sir, I'm changing it now.
Okay, we are seeing your Comsat's member countries and now Comsat's campuses.
Yes.
Seeing this slide.
Okay. Yes, there are different campus of Comsat's university, including the main campus at Islamabad, and then Aptabad campus, Wa campus, Lahore campus, and then Bihari campus, virtual campus, and so on. This is the Department of Biosciences, situated at Comsys University, Islamabad, in the Islamabad campus. And right now we are going to, when we will be physical or during physical appearance, we use this campus for workshops and further seminars and conferences. So there are 101 faculty, out of which 86 are PhDs. And they are teaching and they are doing research in versatile field of interdisciplinary like biology and bioinformatics and then computational biology. Dr. Waseem Haider is now teaching us in the field of bioinformatics, and he is teaching different subjects at Comsys University, Islamabad, like biodata analysis and then next generation sequencing and then some other advanced subjects. There are different kinds of projects that are being held at under his supervision, including some charity work and organizations and seminars we can see in these slides. There are some hands-on workshops and then trainings in the labs. And then these are some training workshop. We can see group photos of the members that are participating in these seminars and in these conferences. And now in this session, inshallah, we will be having a lot of new software trainings and new hand-on training related to bioinformatics, and we are hoping for best learning. Thank you so much. Over to you, Dr. Waseem.
Hey, thank you, Kuratalan. Thank you so much. I'm wondering how to share the class notes for you guys. नौमान, हाउ कैन आई शेयर द क्लास नोट्स हेयर? नॉर्मली तो हम क्लास बनाते हैं अपने उस सेशन में, चैट में, चैट में अटैचमेंट डस
चैट बॉक्स में, आई गेस ये इवेंट मैंने कैलेंडर से क्रिएट किया तो इधर नहीं शेयर होंगे, लेटर ऑन मैं शेयर कर दूंगा इधर ही सर।
इसमें अभी इनको अगर ये वुड यू गाइस वांट टू डू द प्रैक्टिस एज वेल विद अस और यू वांट टू डू दैट लेटर बिकॉज़ आई वांट के यू गाइस शुड आल्सो practice. I'm sorry, I denied this person. It was one request and accidentally I pressed cross sign. Okay, inko in kar lenge. So basically, we do have an Excel sheet to share with you guys. You guys see my screen, some notes. These are the slides, and I should start from here. I should thank Professor Dr. Donald Bullock at University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign, USA, where I did teaching assistant, like the way Omar is has done with us, and like Noman is doing with us. Right. So this was the gentleman from whom I learned the statistics and, you know, Excel, and initially we were doing there is another software, SAS, but that is the commercial one. So, but in the meanwhile, we also explored R and the other free tools, like there is one called Jamovi. And then I realized when I got back that most of the people here do not know how to use Excel for data analysis, because a lot of data analysis facilities available in Microsoft Excel. There is a toolkit even, that is the data analysis toolkit. And by the way, Noman or Waleed, maybe you should get ready, because here I'm having Mac. So probably you need to give them a demo how to do this, activate this data analysis toolkit in Excel, which is already there built in Excel. So I have the Mac version. I've already did that, but for the Windows version, which most of the people will be having, maybe you can share how to do that. I'll ask you to do that. Anyway, so whenever we talk about the data analysis, obviously the most important thing is the statistics. And most of the books, they start with this thing, or this famous quote, which actually Professor Bullock used to say, and that is the quote from a British prime minister. He was there in Britain. So this is that there are three kinds of lies. Lies, damned lies, and there is statistics. And this was the Benjamin Disraeli, the British prime minister, who was there in 19th century. This is his lifespan. You must be wondering why he said this thing. I can give you a clue. Sometimes stats is there to, you know, save you, save your skin. You know, you cannot do the analysis for the whole population. You are restricted because of the resources, so you take advantage of statistics. But sometimes people use it, and sometimes they misuse statistics, or probably even abuse it. So probably this gentleman maybe got offended with that, because you might have seen in the TV serials, or in the advertisements, and you know, on television and in the media, like they present the facts and figures. To sell their products, right? Please switch off your mic. Switch off the mics of the participants. And whoever wants to say something, just click this icon. It's up there where you can see this this hand sign. And then we can see while somebody is raising the hands, if you have any issues, or maybe you can post your query or question in the chat box. All right, so that's what it is. And where were we? Benjamin Disraeli, right? So, yeah. So you might have seen, like, in the advertisements, like this, toothpaste contains that much proportion of iron, or, you know, phosphorus, and, you know, the fuel efficiency of Shell oil is this much, 30 miles per gallon. And, you know, they're making the claims with the help of some data. And over there, they do those statistical tests. So that's why, you know, they are using stats over there. But sometimes people are misusing also, or abusing also. So probably that's why he said it. Because, you know, the latest example here is, like, most of the time the governments, they present figures and facts which are like, you know, poverty is under control and literacy rate is this much higher and everybody's living a, you know, happy life here, and there is no issues, there is no poverty, etc., etc., right? So those sort of things are also there. But whenever let's get back to it, whenever you have the limited resources, you're talking about some populations, but you cannot go and measure everybody and every individual in that population. But you want to take a small subset out of it, over there you need to use statistics, right? Achha, when we talk about statistics, there are two groups we can make. We can classify that. Number one is descriptive statistics, where you describe your data. You describe your data, right? And we'll go into it. And then there is an inferential statistics, where you do some hypothesis testing. You make some hypothesis, and you take a sample, in fact, and then you make an inference using the information from your samples, right? So this theory lecture is not that much. I'll just briefly go over some concepts and then we'll switch to the Excel, and over there I hope you guys would enjoy this session. So in descriptive, we have the central tendency. We measure the central tendency. That means where lies the center of this population, right? So for that, these are the measures for that, measures for central tendency. You go for the mean, you go for the median, you go for the mod, right? So mean is the average, median is the middlemost value, and mod is the most frequently occurring thing. We'll do that in an example in a moment. We are also interested in variability within the data, you know, how these data points, numbers, they vary, right? And we actually calculate this variability from the mean, like how much they vary from the mean or center of the of this distribution of this population. So first thing which we actually calculate is the variance, right? And we calculate the standard deviation from this. We calculate the range. Range is there is a difference between the maximum and the minimum. You get the maximum number, you sort the numbers, you get the maximum and you get the minimum. You can do that in Excel without sorting them even. There are the functions that can do that for you. We'll go over these functions in a moment. And there is another thing that's called as relative standing. So you go for Z scores and percentile ranks. So today's session, I hope will be mainly around this descriptive statistics part. And we might have follow-up sessions, right, for rest of the things. But I would like to switch gears towards Jamovi. That's a very, very handy and easy tool. But in order to understand Jamovi and R and everything, I think Excel is the first step to do that. But obviously you cannot do everything with Microsoft Excel, but that's where you can have a start, right? And you can do a quick analysis of your data, right? But in inferential, just to give you an idea, we look for the variables. Variables kya hote within the data set, we collect numbers. We decide some variables to do our data collection. And these variables may be name, gender, age, right? Religion, you know, weight and height and all those things. So we, in our stats language, we call them as variables. And those variables are, they are having some interdependence on each other, right? So one of them we call it as the independent variable. The other one we call it as dependent variable. Let me show you in a moment real quick these variables. Variables are characteristics of a sample or a population that can vary, and opposite to it is constant. Quantitative variable, numeric hote hain, continuous can be where you can go at any arbitrary units, like weight can be 12.1, 12.12345, depending upon how sophisticated and sensitive your equipments are. So that's why we call them as continuous. So there is a continuous increment or decrement in the numbers, right? Consecutive. Discretes are discrete, whole numbers. It cannot be like one human. It can be one human, but it cannot be like 2.5 humans or 3.5 puppies, right? So you can have a whole number. Sometimes your responses are binary, like yes or no situation, or we replace them with one and zeros, right? So number of students in a class cannot be 165.5, but it can be the whole numbers. It can be the whole number. Mommy go there. Okay. So discrete is the whole numbers, right? The full numbers. Qualitative is where you have categories in the variables. Like for example, in nominal, you have the names, color, race, nationality, gender, right? And ordinal has a little bit order in it, for example, inactive, active, and hyperactive, those sort of things. So, but these are the qualitative variables. So within them, they have the categories. Sometimes those categories, they go in incrementing or decrementing fashions, right? So they have some orders in them, right? And the variables, I'm sorry, a little bit off these slides are because we changed from one operating system to another, and sometimes this also happens, but we're fine. So variables can be classified on the basis of dependent and independent as well, right? So for example, I straight away go to this picture. So I will be a little quick in this because theoretical things are important, so I would like to briefly cover them but not spend much time on them. I can give you the notes where you can study them. So hours you study for some exam. So there is one variable hours and the other variable is your grade. So grade depends upon how many hours you study. So in this way, this variable is independent. It can go by itself, your choice, how many hours you spend, but obviously the grade depends on them. So this gentleman is independent, this gentleman is dependent. So normally we put Y for the dependent variable and X for the independent variable. So Y depends on X, Y depends on X, right? So let me get back to this chart here because I need to have this background for you before you understand this. If independent variable and dependent variable both are continuous and the data is normal, we'll define in a moment a normal data or a normal distribution, looks like a bell-shaped curve, right? So this situation is called as parametric. So in parametric case, if the data is normal, we will go with Pearson correlation, we can go with regressions and those kind of things. If the data is not normal, right, what you do is, and mostly we are focused on these two, since both variables are continuous, we look for whether both of them are normal or they are not normal. So if they are not normal, we can go with Spearman and Kindall correlations rather than the Pearson correlations. If independent variable is categorical and dependent variable is continuous, for example, we are comparing the weights of boys versus girls. So here we have two variables. One variable is weight and the other variable is gender, right? And we say that weight depends on gender. So boys and girls, they weigh differently, right? What are your perceptions? Who should be having more average weight, boys or girls? Anyone? So boys ka technically weight, we expect it is more. So in that case, here your weight depends on gender. So gender is an independent variable and weight is the dependent variable, right? So categorical hai and the dependent variable is continuous. You can apply t-test analysis of variance, covariance, those kind of thing in a parametric situation. If it is non-parametric, there is a sign test. And for ANOVA, the non-parametric alternative for ANOVA is Kruskal-Wallis test, right? Achha. The independent variable is continuous and dependent variable is now categorical, right? So you have, for example, age data or weight data, and now you are looking for numbers, and from the numbers you want to judge whether it's the data is, you know, coming from males or coming from females. This thing is called as classification as well, and that is where we actually start in data science. So over there, the categorical variable, the dependent variable is categorical, right? So we are kind of predicting a categorical variable using continuous independent variables. So parametric situation may you can go with the discriminant analysis. There are not many others, but here we just picked up the main one. And non-parametric situation may you can go with point by serial correlations. If you have both categorical, like independent variable is categorical and dependent variable is categorical, your choice can be chi-squares, okay? Or there is phi also, but I think you guys might have heard or might have gone through this chi-square, the t-test, ANOVA, Pearson correlations and regressions. So I think those of you have taken this undergrad level courses in statistics or biostatistics, or any sort of data analysis things, you might be familiar with them. So that's the inferential statistics, where these tests, we can do that. Everything is there in Microsoft Excel, except those, for example, discriminant and biserial and these alternatives, the non-parametric ones. But obviously there are toolkits also in Excel, which you can import or you can purchase them. There is one package called as Excel Stats. You can purchase that and put it in Excel, and you can go even with the PCAs and all those advanced stuff as well, right? So that's all about a generalized view of the of the data analysis and the things which we have actually do. This is the classical statistics stuff, right? The advanced one is nowadays where the things are going in data science. So over there, you have to, you know, but this background is important. You should know all these things. But actually, the fun starts with regressions. So we start with the linear regressions and then logistic regressions, and then we move on towards further advanced topics, right? Whenever you are doing analysis, obviously you are dealing with the populations, right? And sometimes the population is so big that you cannot go and, you know, do your analysis on each and every individual, right? So population is a big entity. Why this slide is about why we need this statistics, right? Why? Because the population is the set of all measurements of interest to the sample collector, the big entity. And we sometimes are restricted that because of our resources, we cannot measure each and everybody, right? If you go and measure each and everyone in a population, so that's where you don't need statistics like census se hota hai. You calculate each and every individual, right? Count each and every individual in a population. Over there, you don't need statistics. But ideally, this situation is not possible in most of the time. So you take a small subset. There is a big, you know, population of humans or animals, or, you know, lions in an area, or trees in an area. But sometimes you cannot go and measure every tree's width or number of leaves on them or some other parameter, right? So you take a small subset out of it. Whenever you are doing that, you are now doing statistics, right? So objective of the statistics is to make inference about a population based on information contained in a sample. So what is inference? Generalization from a part to the whole. So you do your analysis on the samples and then you generalize the things for your population. Actually, the parameters are anything related to population, like population mean, population's variance, population standard deviation. These things are called as parameters. Parameter. The word parameter is used. Okay, mean is the average, and variance is the measure of variability. We'll do that in a moment. Some calculations, and then you would understand. And then obviously, I will switch gear towards Excel. I'm sorry, I'm delaying that, but that's important to cover this background for you guys. Statistic is anything that is related to sample. So sample mean is represented by X bar. Acha, the parameters are represented by Greek letters like mu, sigma, all those things. But for the samples, we take those English letters. And for example, sometimes we take this X and then we put a bar on it. So that represents the mean X bar. Sometimes we say Y bar, Z bar, any letter we can use, but most frequently we use X or Y to represent the mean. And sample variance is represented by letter S, and there is a square sign on it, square on it. Why there is a square? There is a reason for that. We'll cover that in a moment. And sample median and all those things. So all those things which are related to the sample, we call them as statistic, right? Then what is statistics? Look for this definition as well. So what is statistics then? Can I say statistic is singular and statistics is plural for that? I can say that, I think, right? So statistics is nothing but a combination of those things which are coming or which are you are actually calculating from samples. So there is samples and there are the characteristics, right, or properties of the samples which you are calculating or which you are recording, right? And statistics is combination of all these things. So statistics is all about sampling, right? Having samples and doing analysis on samples. And for this analysis, we need those data analysis toolkits like Excel or Jamovi and every other thing. We covered that. So let me switch gears towards distribution. Thoda sa zara distribution ki bhi baat kar lete hain. Anyone here who has an idea about a normal distribution? Anyone? Our participants? Come on, guys, it's your day.
जी माइक ऑप्शन इनेबल कर दिया गया है, जो बंदा बोलना चाहे बोल सकते हैं।
एनी कमेंट्स फीडबैक आर वी डूइंग गुड?
सर अल्हम्दुलिल्लाह
जी। ओके सो हियर वी हैव सम नंबर्स, लेट मी स्विच ऑन माय पेन, इट्स अ लिटिल बिट वियर्ड, this device sometimes screws up, but bear with me. So we have some numbers, some data set, and this data set is, believe me, very noble, very nice data set. The actual data sets are not like that, but just I want to, you know, communicate with you how we draw those curves, the distributions, right? Distribution is, by the way, the distribution of numbers, how these numbers are distributed, right? So for example, these numbers are there. They were weird, they were disordered, we put them in an order, right? And now we see this, these are our numbers, this is our data, right? By the way, data is a singular as well as a plural word. Okay, so we have ones here. How many distinct numbers we have? We have ones here, we have twos here, we have threes here, right? We have fours here, we have fives, we have sixes, we have sevens, right? From here I will draw a distribution, and then we will try to look a shape from this distribution, and then you would speak out what this shape looks like, right? Acha ji, so we can take these data points and we can construct a frequency table out of it. This, so these distributions are drawn when we talk about a normal distribution, when we talk about the curve, this exactly happens when we make these curves, right? So we have ones here, we have twos here, threes here, fours here, fives here, sixes are here, sevens. How many ones are here in this data set? Tell me quickly, how many ones? It's only one. How many twos are here? How many twos are here?
Two.
How many threes are here?
Three times.
Three.
Very good. Fours. Four hain.
Four times.
Three fives are here.
Three times.
Very nice. Two sixes are here and one seven is there, right? This is how it goes on. So if we put on x-axis, I'm sorry, my line should be straight enough, approximate, close to straight. So on x-axis, we draw those distinct classes or distinct numbers. Acha, we call them bins, right? Right. For example, you have bins in your houses and you put various bins, like, you know, containers where you put your clothes, you put your shoes, you put your electronic devices, you put your books and so on, right? So here these things are similar. So we have those bins 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Depending upon your data set, you will decide your bins. All right, I will use this word bins when we do this analysis in Excel. So how many ones are here? And this is the frequency for x, this any distribution of numbers, x or y's, we can call them y's, these numbers. So this is f or y. Frequency le lete hain yahan pe, y-axis ke upar. This is your y-axis. This is your x-axis, right? So x-axis pe you put the bins, and y-axis pe you plot their frequencies. And how many ones are here? Obviously, this height of this bar is up till this point, one. How many twos are here? We can go up to this point and come back. How many threes are here? We can go like this. How many fours are here? This is for those who have no or zero background of statistics, right? So for them, I think there are some must be there. And if someone is feeling bored of it, I apologize for that. Wait for a moment till we clear some lingo here, some terminologies here, and then I'll get back to the fun stuff. So how many fives are here? Again, four of them. How many sixes? Four fours hain. There are three fives, so yeah, that's fine. And then how many sixes? So there are two of them. And how many sevens? There is one of them. Do you see a shape here? Do you see a shape here? Acha, these are the bar charts or bars. You see various bars here. So this diagram, we can call it as a bar chart. And you can connect them with some curve-like thing where ideally it should go from the center of those bars, but it goes on. But so somewhere you can see a mountain, or you can see a bell shape over here. if your distribution looks like this, the shape of the distribution, obviously the shape is visible when you draw it, right? In Excel, we need to make this frequency table. We need to make the bins, and then we can draw this bar chart. And if those bars are touching each other, we call them as histogram, right? I'll show you in a moment. Right, so here you see a bell, right? A little bit flat bell. Probably I should space all these numbers and it should have been more. Yeah. So this this shape is called as a bar chart. Jo abhi humne dekha. If boundaries are touching with one another, you can call as a histogram. So here we have another situation. We have the range of the numbers. The bins are between 0 to 3, anything between 0 to 3. Sometimes you don't have, you have large many numbers in your data set, so you cannot plot them all. So you decide to make the bins bit wider, where any numbers between 1 and 3, obviously 0 might be there, but any number between 0 to 3, you put them in this bin. 4 to 7 goes here, 8 to 11 go here, 12 to 15 go here, 16 to 19 they go here. You first, come up with their frequency table. This is a frequency table. Now we can do that in Excel. And then we plot this frequency table till we get a shape like this. Acha, here their boundaries are touching. The boundaries are touching to each other. And this shape, we call it as a histogram. Histogram, the previous one where they had, distinct bars, the boundaries were not touching. So that was a bar chart, right? So we'll do that. Histogram, all right. Yeah, here again, you have daily visits, twice a week, weekly, monthly, and obviously these things are not connected with one another. Like over there, the classes, the bins were, or we can then call them as classes as well. So this is the number of cappuccinos made in some coffee shop. So number of cappuccinos made per hour, right? So in between 12 a.m. to 3 a.m., 2 cups are made. Like the frequency is 2. Right, and yeah, 4 to 7 it's more, and 8 to 11 it's the most, right? But this thing over here is called mod, the thing that has the higher frequency. Mod in the curve determines the height of the curve, right? This is the curve. I'm sorry, it's a little bit weird or off. So mod actually determines the height of the curve, right? So most frequently occurring height of the curve determine karta hai. So that's the mod, right? What is mean and median? Mean is the average. Over there in the next diagrams, you have daily and twice a week and weekly and monthly. So over there, these are distinct bars here. They are not adjacent. They are not joining each other. So in that case, this thing is a histogram. Bar chart, my apologies.
Bar chart.
Yeah, previous one was a histogram and this one is the bar chart. Achha, sometimes you are comparing various distributions with one another, or sometimes distributions are weird, right? So you have skewed distributions. They look like this or something like this. Over there, your mean is not exactly in the middle. Achha, by the way, for a normal distribution, mean, mod, and median coincide with each other, exactly. Same thing right here. For example, in this data set, and I said this data set is made by myself, so that is very, very disciplined or very, very good data set, but actual data sets are not like that. So over here, the mean is 4, mean is we calculated that. So sum of all these numbers we represented with this symbol, that's equal to 64, and number of data points here are these total numbers. How many numbers are here? We had 16 numbers here. 16 numbers hai, and their sum is 64. So mean is 64 by 16. So mean is 4, right? Acha, what is the mod here? Mod is the most frequently occurring thing. So we look for frequencies. So this thing, 4, has maximum frequency. And again, height of the curve, you can see that. So mod is also 4, mean is also 4, and median is the middlemost number. For that, what you do is you simply place them in an order. You simply place them in an order, ascending or descending. Generally, we go with this. So these are the 16 numbers. Switch off the Baby wants to join the class. There's a position here, right? So 16 numbers. This was the first number, and this was the number as 16th. And if she sorted their position, let me do it for myself. जी नोमान हो गया
जी सर हो गया
सॉरी आई थिंक आई लॉस्ट माय या एस्केप लेट मी कम बैक ओके सो हियर वी हैव दीज नंबर्स एंड व्हाट वी डू इज वी सिंपली रिमूव दिस थिंग एंड I have also a baby on the back and she's playing on the mobile. Is there any sound disturbing? Background noise to nahi aa raha kuch?
Not yet, sir.
Okay, ji. Okay, so we have those 16 numbers and this was our first number. This was the second. There were two twos there, three threes there. This was the sixth number in our data set. This was the 16th number in our data set, right? So total 16 numbers are here. And we can get the exactly middle point or midpoint, right? So that midpoint is the median. Midpoint is the median, right? So here we have how many numbers? How many numbers? So first we get the median. Median. So 16 numbers. So we can divide them into two equal parts. Equal parts, right? Upper and lower. So divide the data into two equal halves. Upper half and lower half. And now these numbers are even, 16. So we can take the average of middle two numbers. Average of middle two numbers, that is 4 plus 4 divided by 2. So our median is 4. Median is 4. Okay. So what you do next is we can take the average of these two numbers. So that's your median, right? Achha. Now coming back to box and whisker plot, we see the normal curve. And I say sometimes the data is not normal, or sometimes there is a situation where you are comparing various curves with one another, like there is one distribution like this, the other is like this, the other is like this. It's hard to, you know, compare them. So this thing is, or this representation or this figure is good to do that, this box and whisker plot. Box because there is a box in the middle of it, I'll show you in a moment, and whisker is those hair, thick hair of mouse or you know, cat or rats, right? So these are the whiskers. So we have the hairs as well. Somebody looked at it, maybe shaped like a cat hair. Probably whiskers thoda sa tilt kar dein, right? So something like this. Give me 5 minutes, excuse Noman. In the meanwhile, can you go with the data analysis toolkit, please?
Ji, sure, sir.
He showed up. Actually, my father passed away last month, and sometimes people come for prayers. I'll be back as soon as my son joins back. So, Noman, can you please take over the Excel toolkit? And everybody has the Excel, right?
Okay, sir. प्लीज एवरीवन अपने एक्सेल ओपन कर ले. जिन जिन लोगों ने लैपटॉप से ज्वाइन किया वो लैपटॉप पे अपने एक्सेल ओपन कर ले. जी स्क्रीन शेयर हो गया आप एनीवन पहले मुझे इन्फॉर्म कर दीजिएगा कि स्क्रीन शेयर हो गया आप लोगों की
अभी नहीं हुई
अभी
I think so my internet connection is bit slow anyone please abogge
here team
I'm here now Waleed I'm here no worries you can have the setup so I'm back thank you so much so where were we
Jee.
So Anuman maybe you can take some questions in the chat box as well
okay sir
issues to the people there are some comments as well I can see we can do that later on acha ji so these are the
sir slide share kar de
oh I'm sorry do we have any international student here anyone who can only understand english this technique is called as code switching in teaching so you change to different languages and sometimes you know that works for the students so my apologies if I'm doing that a little bit Urdu as well but maybe you can get familiar to some of the terms here so kya keep it low sorry let me remove this thing screen shared
yes sir
you can see my screen
ji sir
yes sir
okay acha so what happens over here is by the way this is also called as quartile plot right so we distribute our data into quarters right 1/4 1/4 right so you have the lower 1/4 and you have the middle we can say lower middle and upper middle and then we have the upper class like you know four classes in some society okay the lower most and you know upper middle and then lower middle and what is that upper middle and then the upper class right so we split the data into four equal parts and this is also called as then I think I should add here as well quartile anyone know have any idea about percentile ranks or percentiles are given to your GRE scores or what ki Pakistan mein kya hota hai yaar ye which you do for your HEC scholarships NTS
head test
NTS exam right so your NTS exam you are given some percentile score as well sometimes you know parents they come and say like my son has got a percentile of 90 but ComSats did not give admission and that means 90% of the population is below that gentleman right and if you include that maybe you know he's at the 90th and in that case you are including this percentile thing the percentile of that particular individual as well so including that gentleman you can have he's at the 90th so 89% is below that gentleman or lady score 89% of the population right so he's at the 90th percentile so percentile what does that mean percentile means what out of
100
very good right basically the actual term is quantile means you quantify or you break the things into equal quantities sometimes you make 10 parts of your data set so in that case you call it as decile jaise deci hota hai deci decile okay quartile is you divide the data set into four equal parts right so here for example in order to break this thing into four equal parts you need to make it into first two equal halves then you take the lower half and you know make it further half right and so now you have this half where you have the eight numbers again even numbers if you have the odd numbers you will go and pick up the middle thing, exactly in the middle. What thing you get in the middle, that's what you pick it, right? And if you have the even numbers, in that case, you can get the average of the middle two things, okay? So this thing was the highest in the lower half, and this is the first in the upper half, so you take the average of both of them. You want to divide it into quartiles, four equal parts. So you, first we divide it into two equal parts. We put a line here. What we call this thing? We use the term for this. What is that? The midpoint, median. Median, right? So I can write it here. I'm sorry, my writing is a little bit weird, but median. Now you can take the lower half and divide it into two equal parts again. So 8 numbers are here. Forget about the numbers, the actual numbers. This is their serials or the position. The position they have, so look into this. So we see that we have the 8 numbers here, right? So what is the half of the 8? 4. So anywhere between, now again, these are the even numbers, so we take average of these two numbers, right? So once we determine its position, and then we take the actual number. The actual number at position number 4 was 3, and position number 5, it's also 3. So this is the number here. Right, and we draw a line here in this box plot, the line here in this box plot, and then we take the upper half and again divide it into two equal halves. So now again we have the top 8 numbers, so 9, 10 and 11 and 12. So it is anything anywhere between 12 and 13 numbers. So that is where you cut it, this thing into half again. So you take the whole thing, divide it into two equal halves. Then you take the lower half, divide it into two. So two parts from the lower half. Same way you take the upper half, again divided into two pieces, right? So this is how you do that. So this, you draw a line here, draw a line here. This thing is called as the lower quartile. Lower quartile, or we call it as Q1, quartile one, quartile one. If this is Q1, then this is the Q2, quartile two, or median. That is the same thing, right? And this thing is Q3, the upper quartile, the third quartile, right? So 3/4 of the population is up to this point, right? And now we join all these lines together. They make your box. They make your box. This middle line, thick, middle thick line in the middle is, the thick line in the middle is the median, right? What do you want? There is a baby here and I think she wants to communicate with you guys. Would you like to meet her? And then this is the minimum. For the moment, I will leave it with the minimum and maximum. I'm not going into what this darn thing is, lower fence and upper fence. You want to go more technical? These fences are calculated with some formula, but I don't want to make it complicated only for you. So min or max. But actually in real life, these are the fences. We calculate them with a formula, lower fence and upper fence, right? If some number over there, these antennas, they go, right? The lower one and the upper one, right? So this way, these antennas, somebody looked at it like whiskers of this, let me get rid of this pen. Right, so whiskers are, somebody looked at it like whiskers. Whisker is the thick hair of the mouse and the cat. So box on whisker plot, we also call it, or box plot or quartile plot. So you divide the data into four equal parts, four equal halves. Up till this point, Q1 is where you can have the lower 25% of the population, a lower quartile. This is the 50th position, right? The 50% of the population is below this point. 50% is above this point. For example, these are the data which measures the economy. So for example, how many dollars this population is getting per hour, right? So if you are getting this $3 or below, the actual number at Q1 is 3. So up to $3. Up to $3 means $3 and below. So 25% of the population is, underemployed, they are getting $3 and below. 50% of the population or half of the population is $4 or below per hour. I'm telling the wages or the are wages over there, and the white collars, like good jobs over there, research scientists, or you know, the people working in the labs or in hospitals, or you know, good jobs. So they are like, you can have $5 per hour, something like that, something like that. So we use this thing as to make inference about this population. You divide the, you take the whole distribution and you divide it into four equal parts. And this representation is good while you have multiple populations and you want to compare them. So you can draw the box plots and compare these distributions with each other. You might have seen these pictures in your you know, literature, in your books as well, right? So that's it. And there are some other things which we calculate for distributions: mean, variance, skewness, kurtosis. I hope you guys know these things. Mean is the average. Variance we calculate with the help of deviations. Skewness, hard to, you know, go with the formula here. And kurtosis, these are just the things that tells about the shape of the distribution, right? We'll get back to variance for a moment. Average of squared deviations. Squared deviation, like how values or numbers, they deviate from the mean. How numbers, they deviate from the mean or the average. I think let's go ahead and do it in Excel and then it will be clear. So this is the formula for population variance. You take the average of those squared deviations while dividing with N. In samples, you do it not, you don't divide it by some of those deviations. I think let me do it for you guys real quick. Let me take a small data set here before we proceed. Okay, so for example, you have the numbers here 1, 2, and 3. Tea or coffee, please. Achha. It's on 27. Yes. So these are the numbers 1, 2, and 3. Three numbers. Suppose this is our data set, and again, in real life, you will get quite weird numbers, right? Itna Nobel or Sharif data aapko nahi milega. Anyway, so what is some of these numbers? Some of these numbers? By the way, how many numbers are here? How many numbers are here? 1, 2, and 3. These are three numbers, right? And actual numbers are 1, 2, and 3. Just I picked up these three decent numbers. What is some of these numbers? Some of these numbers. Some of these numbers is 1 plus 2 plus 3. That's equal to 6, right? So mean is 6 divided by 3. So mean is equal to 2. Average is equal to 2, right? So these are your numbers. And we can calculate their deviations. How do these numbers, they deviate from the mean, right? So mean is 2 here, 2 here. So how this first number deviates from the mean? So we can go 1 minus 2 to calculate its deviation. So that's equal to minus 1. Second number, the deviation from the mean is 2 minus 2. That's 0. And third number is 3 minus 2. That's equal to 1 plus 1. You take the sum of these deviations, sum of these, that's equal to 0. You can take any data set, and I challenge you, sum of deviation will always be 0. All right? But we wanted to calculate how at the average these values, they deviate from the mean. We cannot do it if we use deviations. So what you do is you take the squares of these deviations. You just take the d squares. So 1 square is 1, 0 square is 0, minus 1 square is 1, 0 square is 0, and 1 square again is 1. So sum of these numbers is, or sum of those square deviations, that's equal to, I'm sorry, I can write it here. So that's equal to 2. Now you get a number, right? In case it's a population, achha, this term is yours, this thing right here. This thing right here, and this summation is right here. So this whole thing we calculated, that number is 2, and divided by n is equal to 3 if you're doing it for a population. And if it is a sample, suppose it's not a population, it's not only these three numbers, you can go and collect the numbers, and next time you end up with any other numbers. So in that case, we assume that this thing is not a population. These are the samples. So this is the sample, sorry. So if it's a sample, you do it with n minus 1. There is a phenomenon related to this. It's called as degrees of freedom. Not covering that, but degrees of freedom is n minus 1. So for that, you can take those sum of those square deviations, that was 2, and you divide it by 2. Your answer is equal to 1. So this thing which you actually calculated is the variance. For population variance, we put a single the symbol as sigma, the parameter, and this is a statistic, by the way, we covered that. So for that we use the English letter S. So this is how you calculate the variance. What is standard deviation? Actually, we wanted to have the average of those deviations. At the average, how the values they deviate from the mean. But we cannot do that because sum of D was 0. So we were not able to get sum of D divided by N thing. That was the standard deviation. So in order to do that, we took a detour. We took those deviations square. So we ended up with this thing, sigma square variance. That's why there is a square sign here and here, right? And since you square that, now you can get the standard deviation back from it. You have the sigma square, you have the S square for population and sample, and from here you can get sigma or you can get S. How you do that? How can I do that? If you have one thing which is squared, right? And I want the original thing back from this. How can I do that? Anyone? What should I do?
Square root.
Very good. You can take the square root. If you take the square root, obviously you can get this thing. So you take the square root of this thing. That's equal to, I'm sorry, parameter hai. My writing a little bit weird. My apologies. And this is for sample standard deviation. All right. Yeah, you must be getting bored of it. There is one thing which we call it as CV, coefficient of variation. So that is this is actually given by standard deviation divided by mean, and then you take it in percentage. Okay. Skewness is, if your distribution is skewed to the right or left, a skewed distribution is, I think I should get rid of my pen and I can have mouse back. Yeah. So whoever speaks, this picture comes in the session. Skewness. So this is the measure of how much a distribution is pulled from symmetric. For a perfect normal distribution, mean and mod and median, they all coincide with each other, right? Exactly the same place or same number. If you have mean on this side and then there is median here and then there is mod here and the distribution seems like skewed towards left side or pulled towards left. This is not a normal distribution, right? This is called a skewed distribution. If it is skewed to the left, you see, by the way, your left side, not the curve's left side. For the curve, it's the right side. But since we are looking from opposite side, so we are determining it from our side as well. So negatively skewed is skewed to the left, right? Over here, the mean is pulled towards left. Why it happens in a data set? Why there are the skewed distributions? Ideally, the distributions should be normal. But in real life, most of the things are not normal, not ideal, okay? So there are the deviations from normality, idealism. All right, because you are living in this world. It's not heaven. Everything will be ideal, perfect, right? So if you have small numbers in your data set and large many of them, they would pull the mean towards them. If you have large numbers in your data set, you would pull the mean towards them. And then the mean will be on this side. So in that case, the distribution is skewed to the right. Actually, this line then becomes parallel to the axis and keeps on going right towards infinity. This towards negative infinity, this towards positive. This is how these curves they go in ideal situation, because here we are looking for a sample, but actually the things are coming from some populations. All right. So mean is pulled towards right side, positively skewed, left side, negatively skewed. Another deviation is the shape. if you look a shape like a perfect bell shape or this perfect bell curve, this is called as mesocortic. This thing is called as kurtosis. Kurtosis means measure of peakedness. How peak, how sharp is your peak or how flat is your peak. Leptocortic, longer tails and very sharp distribution. Somebody looked at it like two kangaroos with longer tails facing each other. Use the word leptocortic, longer tails. Meso, middle. Platycortic. Somebody looked at it like platypus, an animal, right? So flat distribution. For that, we measure a parameter or we measure a, you know, characteristic that's called as K. So K is equal to 0 for a mesocortic situation. K is greater than 0 for a leptocortic thing. And K is less than 0, a negative number. If K is a positive number, then your distribution is something like that. Sometimes we don't draw those distributions. We just do some statistical test in Jamovi. There are the buttons, you just click them and then they give you the number K. If that K is equal to 0 or close to 0, that means your distribution is normal. You don't even need to look, draw the curve or draw the shape of that distribution, right? In leptocortic situation, you would get a K greater than 0, some positive number. In platycortic, you will get some negative number. And again, in skewness also, negative number, a negatively skewed thing, positive number, a positively skewed thing, big number, more skewed, right? Further smaller number is more skewed to the left. Higher positive number is highly positive or highly skewed to the right, right? So these are, and this is a normal distribution, standard normal distribution. And this is associated with one thing which is called as standardized value or Z-score. Z-score is the measure of how many distributions somebody is away from the mean, right? So you take all those numbers and you can calculate their relative standing. Where do these numbers, or these individuals, they stand in a distribution? That's measured with the Z-score or standardized value. And that's it. All right. Let me get back to Excel. And first, I have a sheet where I have the data sets, right? So various data sets which we actually collected some numbers. Noman, maybe now you can take this, just briefly tell them about this data analysis toolkit on Microsoft Office and Microsoft Excel in Windows. And then I can take the charge back again. I need a short break.
Okay, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Kindly let me know when screen share.
Okay, yes, sir.
Gee, okay. We can see that.
Okay, go to file section, like here, yes, and then click on more, and here is the options. Click on it. Then here, this screen will pop up. Then you need to click on addings. After that, you will see multiple options here. Here is the option analysis tool bag. If it doesn't appear over here, you can select from there. From down, then click on go, and afterwards you just need to check it. If you already have not enabled it, then this option is empty. You just need to check it and click on OK. Now you can go to a data tab, and here in the data tab, data analysis toolkit has been enabled. where you can have multiple options for different kinds of tests and descriptive statistics as well. Any questions you may can ask? Let me repeat it again. Go to file options, then click on more, and then options. After that, add-ins. In add-ins, click on analysis tool pack VBA. After that, click on go, and in that, you just need to active this one, and click on OK. After that, in the data tab, you will see an option by name data analysis. Here it is.
Thanks, Noman. Yeah, I took 3 to 4 sips of tea and it made me fresh. And yeah, can you tackle those questions in chat box?
Jiji sir, karon sir.
Okay, so let's have some fun with Excel. Let me share my screen. Please give us the feedback as well when we end up this thing, and then maybe we can make a further improvement so that the option is not visible in Excel 19. Noman, can you please look into this? Acha ji, Mac users, they can come with me. So for us, we can go to tools, and directly it's Excel add-ins. Tools, Excel add-ins, it's already checked. I'm sorry. Suppose it was not checked, so I just need to check it here. So in Mac, you need to go into data. No, not this one, this data tab. Where is that? Tools, and Excel add-ins, simple. And you just simply check it. All right, and then it comes into data right here, data analysis. And then we can do this data analysis. But before we do that, let's get familiarized with Excel. So we collected some data from our students, maybe, or you know, these are the students and these are their gender and age and height and weight, and hair color and eye color, and have you had any broken bone, your dominant hand, are you smoker or non-smoker, and this is the information which lies in front of us. This is our data, actually. And we'll do some we'll calculate some parameters from this data set, right? And then obviously there will be then our informations, and based upon that information we will derive from some knowledge out of it. So there is data, there is information, and there is knowledge. All right, okay. So as I say, before you go to Excel, you see that these are the columns. So the data is in two dimensions, right? It's in rows or it's in columns, right? So it's 2D, two dimensions. Columns here are labeled. These are the labels, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. So these are the labels, right? And rows are numbered. So these are the numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The individual pieces we see here, they are called as cells, okay? And every cell has an address. So that address is the intersection of columns and rows, right? For example, we click this cell and there is an address bar up here. Address bar, which is right here. So it says B3. So right now we are in B3. Right here it is. It is what? C4. So the column first and then row. C4. In R it's other way around. It's, if you were in R, he would have called it as 4 and then C. So row first over there. Anyways. Can you tell me what is written in D5? What is written in
D5?
5149. We need to process this, and obviously these are the variables which we have it in Excel. You can go there and simply, you know, give them some colors, right? That's what you can do. And these are different variables which we place them in columns. So gender is a variable, age is a variable, height is a variable. Can you tell me what sort of variable is this, gender? What sort of variable is this, gender?
L.
Qualitative or quantitative? Continuous or categorical?
Qualitative.
Very good. So you have qualitative, right? So qualitative. All right. So we have, you know, categories here, male and female. What about age? What about age?
Continuous.
Very good. And within gender, you have two situations. So it can be either male or female, right? So in that case, you can call it as binomial as well. Binomial as well. Okay. This one is nominal. All right. So nominal, named, red, brown, black. Okay. If you have the shades in them, like colors, for example, and you know they are order. So in that case, you can treat it as ordinal. Again, broken bone, yes or no. So again, one of the two things, either yes or no. So this thing is also binomial. So you, for example, want to do the analysis with gender and broken bone. So both are categorical. Which test you gonna apply? The test you gonna apply? What comes to your mind? We covered in a slide back there. You want to compare age and height, and you believe that height depends on age. Right, so both are continuous. In that case, you can go with the correlations. You can go with the regression thing. All right, we'll do that in a moment. So gender, categorical, age, continuous, and so on, and so on. Right. We prepared a small, you know, list of items. Like this, so that information we actually want to get from this. But in Excel, you see at the top, this is one sign, this something. That is where these functions are. Functions are. What are functions? Function is, you know, like in your calculator, you have the functions plus. You know, you want to add two things. There is an addition plus sign, right? You want to subtract two things, negative sign, minus sign. So all those things. What we call them as functions, okay? In computer language, a function has a name, and this function also has another thing which we call it as an argument, name and argument, right? So first we can call a function. For example, here we just click this thing and there is more function in it as well. We want to do frequency, we want to get median, we want to get, so we can, or even we can search from here as well. We can search from here. For example, I want to call a function like t dot test or t dot distribution. So all those functions are here, right? Okay. So since I go there, there was this function up here, and that was my choice. Where you should call this function? Where you should call this function? You can call it in the cell where you want to have the answer, where you want to have the solution, right? So we click in into that cell. The thing is called as hovering of the mouse. Mouse like as if you are boom, you are hovering. You hover the mouse and you go to L2. Right now, L2, we want to do this thing. We want to get a max, we want to get a range, want to get a mean and median and all those things, right? Achha, before we do that, you can get minimum and maximum. And this we are doing it for only one data set, that is the age. Next time we will use the toolkit. Right now we are doing these all functions manually one by one, just to learn how these functions they work in Excel. Some of you might have been familiar with that, and some of you might have never known that this thing is there in Excel. Okay, we can do that with an ordinary method, I would say, desi tarika. You can go here, sort, and you can sort on, for example, age, smallest to largest. Or you can go with the descending order, larger to smallest, right? Largest to smallest. So we can go with smallest to largest. So you can get an idea from here directly that minimum age is 17. And again, you sort it. Either you can do it like this, or you can go with the. So largest value over here is 69. Just to teach you that you can sort the data like this in Excel. But obviously we can get the minimum. This the data set is so big. and there are so many other, you know, variables here, so you cannot do sorting all the time. Better you should apply these functions. So we go here, we go with this min, and within min it automatically applies to whatever you have on the left hand side. That we don't want, that we don't want. We want the min. We just remove that, and now this is how this function is applied. All right, so min, and then these are these brackets. One is the name of the function, and there is he placed an equal to sign. Equal to sign means whenever you place an equal to sign, for example, I can do this manually without going here. I can write equal to, and I know there is a function called as min, so I just type min. So whenever I placed equal to sign, now Excel is expecting a function here that now this gentleman is going to call a function over here, right? So I just press M and he started suggesting me that I have these functions listed with M. So I can pick mine, or even I can type it, all of it. And then it opens up a bracket over here. Right? Either you can give the numbers here yourself, like 1, 3, and 4, and then you just close this parenthesis, right? And he gives you the minimum value by itself. Or you can apply this function to some column. And for that, we wanted to go for which column? And in that column are numbers. They actually go from here. You can click into this. Sorry, I forgot the bracket. Control Z is to call that thing. So min, and I can click here, right? And then with the right click pressed, I can drag it down. And sometimes I have huge numbers down there in that column, so I cannot do that. So maybe I can also type it like this as well. B2 to B58, there's a column, right? You put a column sign, you do that. So minimum number is 17, right? So whenever there is minimum, there is maximum as well, right? So R, you can also apply this function like this, equal to min, and you can go and just click here, so this will apply. But I forgot again the bracket. So min here and here, yeah, B to B. So whatever is there in the B, so it will exclude the empty cells and it will give me the result from the whole column. So that you can also do that. That you can also do that. Whenever there is min, there is a max as well. So I can put it real quick because running short of time. Can we go beyond 4 o'clock? I'm okay, I'm fresh. So you guys can comment in the chat box and Noman can tell me. So maximum number which we get over here is 69. What is range, by the way? Range, max minus min. So it is equal to, and then I just click here, L3, and I put a dash sign, minus L2, right? That's what it is, it should be, so I can get it. The range is 52. So minimum age is 17 here in this class and maximum is 69. So there is a range like 52 over there. In our classes, we had the undergrads as well, and sometimes you find a student with age like 69, even after the retirement, they decide to become a medical doctor or engineer or, you know, aviation pilot or something like that. Sky is the limit over here. We believe now we took pre-medical in FSC and then we are done with our life. That's it. Uske baad mud ke humne, you know, idhar udhar nahi dekhna, jaise wo tange ka ghoda hota hai, uske idhar wo aankhon pe lage hote hain. So apni language mein baat karunga taaki baat Pakistan tak hi rahe. Anyways, so yeah, but again, that's a good approach as well in a sense, because you are focused and you are more targeted. But sometimes, you know, people believe, like my physician, I asked him, like, when you became physician, he was like at the age of 50. I was like, what you were doing before? He said military service. He said it was his dream to become a physician, but he could not do it. So doing multiple jobs, and finally there came a time where he wanted to, you know, become which actually he wanted to become. So he became that. Yes. So 69, maximum 17 is the minimum. Mean, average ke liye, what should be the function? Mean. For mean, what should be the function? Anyone? Should be something like mean. No, there is nothing like that, because
average.
Yeah, so they went with the average, right? Average. So average for these numbers, real quick. I can go with the actual numbers here as well. D2 to, I know my data ranges from B2 up till, you know, here, B58. And there is a shortcut as well. Shift down arrow key. So you will go to the last cell. Median, the function is median, right? So median over this, that you can get it. 20. Mod function is, I'm sorry, but I forgot. Let me put in the middle. I cannot move till I remove those equal to signs here. Yeah. So mod dot singular would return the first mod if you have more than one mod, and mod dot mult will tell you that there are other mods as well. So sometimes you get a bimodal or trimodal distribution. There are two numbers or three numbers that are having the same highest frequency. So safe to go with the mult dot mod, but again, it will give us the first one, which actually it strikes. All right. Standard deviation. So for that, there's a function, standard deviation. Standard deviation dot s, if it's a sample, this is a sample, of course, the students in our stats class. And obviously we want to talk about or infer the pattern for the whole students in University of Illinois or USA or ComSats. That's our population under question. So let's treat it as a sample. So std dot s, that you can do it over here, right? So 8.145, that's the standard deviation. Again, we can get those box plot things, the quartiles 1, 2, and 3. Q2 is same as median, so maybe we can ignore that, but there is a function they gave us, that's quartile, inclusive and exclusive. Any exactly that value should be included or not included, or you want the value below that point, or so let's go with this one, which is the simple quartile. You give the array means you give the data set for which you want to make this quartile. And in this, and again here he's asking for two things. Number one, array means the data set. And by the way, I think I mentioned that this thing is called as arguments. So every function has a name, and then the everything within the bracket we call it as an argument. So this function quartile actually needs two arguments. Number one, Array means the data set actually. Array we call in computer science as the numbers which are in a consecutive or a series, right? Arranged in an ordered, right? Array of digits. Second argument is one. So one will return us the first quartile. So first quartile for this data set is 19. 25% of the population. Like if you take this data and divide it into four equal parts, so 25% of the population is 19, up to 19 years of age. They may be 0 to 19 or anything between them. So 19, that is our quartile 1. Q2 is the same as median, but since we are using the function quartile, is that this one? I'm sorry, I just pressed enter. Before, yeah, so quartile, now it's applying here in this. You guys hear me?
Ji, sir.
Ji, second yes, quartile.
Sir. Yeah.
So that is the 20. So Q3 is quartile. नीचे छुप रहा है. So quartile, and then again we can go with this and third quartile. 75th. अच्छा quartile in terms of percentile अगर देखें तो Q3 is 75th percentile. Make it into 100 equal parts. 75th. Achha, how many values are here? There's a function called as count. So you can go with the count how many non-zero numbers are here or values are here, and 57. So in your data set you have 57 numbers you can check that manually. The last row is 58. These are 58, while we have 57 here. Oh, we got one header here. One column, line, one row says a header. Yeah. G, bilkul. This, that's header, right? So, yeah. You guys are right. Thank you so much. All right. Achha ji. Ab thoda sa, achha, isi cheez ko hum kar lete hain with the help of data analysis toolkit. But before we do that, let's have some more fun. I think Excel, for Excel, we might need another class. That's next Monday. Maybe we can do that. Number of female students. Number of female students. Number of female students, right? So for that, how can you do that? Either one thing what you can do is you can go with desi tarika. So you sort them, sort on gender, A to Z, right? And females, and that's up till here, 32. And then there is a header at the top. So 32 minus 1, it's 31 females. And males are starting from 33, right? So it is 30, it's anything minus 32, right? So 58 minus 32, whatever that number is, I think 26. So that's so that's one thing which you can do that, but here the function for it, function for us, that is the count if here to here in this range. Again, we give the range from here to here. Count if you find a letter like female, your type of word here, female. There are more categories. I'll show you another smarter way. Double quotes needed. It's wrong. Yeah, double quotes needed. So maybe you can check in Mac. Double quotes are needed here, but so 31. So it calculates for us. So what is the function? Count if these. This is the range, right? So it's went there in that variable gender. And then we asked for, we will put it there as hard coded, it should be female. Or you can also do it like this. For example, I write here female. I think they are all capital letters. So maybe let me check if it is case sensitive or not. Case sensitive means you should have the same uppercase or lowercase, right? Caps lock, capital letters are the small letters, right? So we can apply this thing over here. So count if, and what was that? This was the count if this one to this one is this M1 mein jo bhi cheez padi hai. So it works. So it's not case sensitive, right? So that's, you can also do that. And who would tell me, how can I do that for the males? How can I do that for the males? Can you tell me the function over here? How can I apply the function? So we can go like count. Which function I should go? Equal to count if. G. What is the first argument? Go to B. And you can also tell him, like B2, say you should go to B58 tak jaye and count if they are male, right? That's wrong. Oh, sorry, I'm looking for B, whereas it's not in B, it's in A. So this is how we can get the frequency table or frequency thing for a categorical variable, right? Dusron ka continuous ka main batata hun, that's easier. Number of female smokers. Females bhi chahiye and smokers bhi chahiye. So one thing you should go on this column. Other thing you should go on smoking status. So males who smoke and females who smoke. So now you are operating on two columns. What are you gonna do then? In Excel, thanks to them, they came up with count ifs, right? So you give the criteria range one and then criteria one. So criteria range one means give the column. This to this is, what do you want? Female, female, and criteria range two, and then go into this column I to I or I2 to I58. You can write, or you can just click the first one, I2, and then drag it down with the cursor. And then if it is for smoker, what we need? Female smokers, right? For smoker, you should have been having Y here, Y. So two females are smokers, right? And again, you can go like COUNTIF, or here is one thing I can tell you. You can apply the same function downwards. You go here, you hover the mouse, it's white, the cross is white. You go to the right bottom of the cell, and here it becomes, this cursor becomes black, the cross is black, so you just drag it down, you drag it down, same thing applies down there. But here, we don't want females, we just want males, so we can just simply change it. So there are the four males who are smokers, right? This is how you can do that. This is how you can do that, right? Achha ji. So total smokers, non-smokers, female smokers, non-smoker, this you can fill it up. And for percentage, it's very simple. The percentage of the females in the total population is 31. This number divided by total. What is total? 58. And you put asterisk. Asterisk will multiply this thing. So start using Excel as a calculator. Excel is a calculator, right? It's an advanced calculator, right? Don't just use it to fill up your numbers or store your data. Do this data analysis with that, right? I hope you are motivated. If not, my apologies for that. Maybe I did bad. So you can go here, cross is black, drag it down. So now you see that the function applied to the previous function was at the top, it was applied to N2, and when since you moved down, as soon as you moved down, it got applied to N3, that's what we want, N3, right? To that point, so when you drag it down, okay, this thing is called as reference. So the cell which actually it was using or referring to, so reference initially over here was, I'm sorry, so there it is N3, and over here the reference is N2. So as you move down, your reference also moves. You can move right, your reference also move one column to the right. You move down the row, take the same function, it moves downstairs. So here we can go here. So that is, yeah, 2 out of 58. Kitne percent hai? 3.4% of the girls are smokers, and boys should be double than that. 6.89% of the boys are smokers. All right. So their total, mein agar aap dekhein, so they are 6.8% and they are 3.4%. So they are like twice. Proportion is twice large as compared to the females. So that's what you do with this data set, right? Achari, how we can do this thing with the Excel toolkit? That's real quick. So for that, one thing is there are limitations to that. So you go to data, you go to data analysis toolkit, and here first we go with the descriptive thing. So descriptive thing, input range. So let me apply this thing from here to say here. These three columns I want to do my analysis. And I can go here, and down there is one thing, and I just checked this thing because, and then my data is in columns. So right now my data is in column, that's already checked. And labels in first row. Do we have labels in first row? Yes, that's it. So we just check this thing. Output range, if you don't do this thing, output range, it will write your results where your data is, and then the data will be gone forever. Data will be gone forever, okay? And what I want from this, I want a summary statistics. I just checked this thing. But before, I need to tell him the output range. So I want this gentleman to give me the results. Okay, I just click here. They just click in some empty cells and my results will be there. Yeah, or maybe I can get rid of this thing and I can come over again. So let me make it smaller. Yeah, now I can see them. So again, I can go to data analysis, or maybe, you know, that descriptive thing, descriptive statistics, and the cells which I want to do, they're already selected. The previous selection is already there, so I'm fine. Label in first rows, summary statistics, and output I can simply click, for example, here in one of the empty cells, and now I'm fine. What I do is, okay, descriptive input range contain non-numeric data. So it will not do that because you have some non-numeric data. Where is non-numeric data? He says data analysis toolkit applies only to the numbers. Yeah, so first gender column is non-numeric, right? So maybe then I can go back. For them, for those categorical things, I can go with the frequency tables, which I can go with COUNTIF, or there is another thing called as frequency. I'll show you in a moment. It's not there in this data analysis toolkit. So Excel data analysis toolkit can give you a ANOVA, correlation, covariance, and some other things which are here, but yeah, it's not everything is here, but I think 90% of what you need, the biologists and, you know, other researchers, the things are here, but obviously for them who want to go further, there are other tools also. Okay, so we, most of the time we use Excel, but there are the things which we call it as limitations to it. So yeah, we cannot rely on that. These are various sheets where I've done multiple things like box plots and percentile and, you know, those frequency tables and plotting of those diagrams, the curves. I will come back to this. So you go here again, and now I decided to select these cells, right, in this data set. And again, I said, if you just simply click on all those columns, still you are fine. I think rest of the things are okay. Output range bhi theek hai, yahan pe honi chahiye thi. Labels, summary statistics, and columns mein hai data, not in the rows. So that's what it gave me. He says the age average is 22 point. When he gave me mean, standard error, median, mod, standard deviation, sample, kurtosis, skewness. What are your thoughts? Kurtosis, right? Positive number. Sharp head distribution, skewness, data is skewed towards right. Height is skewed towards left. Here kurtosis is negative. So in height data, slightly negative, but seems like fine, close to zero number is okay. Range is 52, minimum, maximum, sum, and count. It did not give us quartiles. So again, you need to do that with the other functions, which we already did that, right? So this is how you can get the for this age data, you can get for this height data, you can get for this weight data real quick. Okay. All right. So now we switch gears towards another thing, box plot, in which we want to calculate quartile 1, quartile 2, 3. We already did that. IQR is simply Q3 minus Q1, so that you can practice. So that is basically, I can write it here, Q3 minus Q1. You can practice this sheet, calculate these things, and lower inner fence and lower outer fence and upper inner fence and upper inner, these formulas are right here. But if you do it, and this index I already placed, so you have the data set here, right? These numbers, how many numbers are here total in this data set? We have 25 numbers, right? So in 25 we have the exactly in the middle, so middle is 13th number right here, so that's your median. Then you have the this half, again even numbers, so middle two, unka average, either middle two, inka average, right, the upper quartile, or you can go directly here and use those Excel formulas for that. Box plot two, again there is a practice that you can do. For percentile, this is a data set, these are the scores which we get for these various students. There are how many, 10 into I think 100 students. So we simply sort them, and there's a function called as percentile. So for that you can simply go percentile.inc inclusive, this number inclusive, right? So there is percentile exclusive, you exclude that number, so you can give the numbers from here to here, all those numbers, and then you can calculate there X, which percentile you want, actually. This number, iska percentile kya banega for this number, right? So that is 0.977. Acha, one thing, when you take this function and when you move downwards, what happens over here is here your row also changes in the reference. That we don't want. That we don't want. So for that, what you do is you put a dollar sign here, A1, and then you put up till your last cell is, you just click it here, J, and then you put a dollar sign over here. So if you move down the row, now your reference, so J10, and then here is L1. So I want to do it for L1, and then I want to do it for L2, and so on. Okay. So L1, and then here L2, again, I'm sorry. So A dollar one, J dollar 10. That's what I did, and we do it for L1, and then now it will not change. So now it is perfect. So all those things, these three gentlemen, they got a score of 100. So their percentile rank is shared. So everyone has got a percentile of 97.8. The notes are there. Over there, you can see all those things by yourself with Excel screenshots and different data sets. They are here. One thing I'm going to cover before we leave, and what are the comments, Noman, by the way? Can we cut down some further minutes?
Sir, let me make the changes.
Mm-hmm. Oh, this will end up? Meeting will end up?
I guess, yes.
There is a bus data here, so we have those numbers, and we know there are the unique numbers which we can get it. So we know there are ones here, there are twos here, there are threes here, fours here. So we want to plot that histogram for these numbers, and we make the bins as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So ideally we have these numbers in this data set, and distinct numbers in this data sets are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, right? 1 to 10. Sometimes you get hundreds, thousands. In that case, you decide like everything between 0 to 20 as a bin, and 20 to 40. Like, for example, in the second case, I change those bins to, I made 5 bins for that. Here I made 10 bins, right? So same way what we did in our example and PowerPoint, how many ones are here, how many twos are here. That's what I want to do, okay? For that, either you can go with COUNTIF thing. COUNTIF, this one to this one is this, and then it will give you the counting. But there is another function called as frequency in Excel. Okay, this frequency function has a trick in it. So you cannot apply directly. First, you need to check this cell. Now, with shift, you click here. So this whole thing is selected. Then you write equal to, and then you write frequency. In data array, you select the data. So data is actually, I intentionally put this data in three separate rows. I would have just one column, but just to tell you like this, how even you can select. So your data goes from A2 up till J4, right? So that's what I did. And then bins. So bins, they go from, I don't know, it's hiding behind that, but yeah, maybe I can get rid of this thing. So this thing goes from here. Maybe I can go with the drag thing. Yes. So bins, they go from here to here. So he's going into what this frequency is doing. He's going into this data set and look for the bins. So first number over here was, for example, 1. So how many ones are here is picking it from there, right? How many twos are there, how many threes are there, and so on, right? So A10, not A10, I'm sorry, I think I forgot. The data starts from A9 and it goes till 19 kar diya, sorry, A9 to A18. That's it. And you close the bracket, and then you do shift control and enter. So it will calculate all those frequencies for you. The function is frequency. How many ones are here in this data set? There are 2 ones, which we get it here. How many twos are here? 1, 2, and 3. Just to verify that, there are 3 eights and so on, right? And then you can make a proportion. So total percentage or proportion you can get it, like how many. So there are 2 out of 30. So they are like what proportion they make out of total. That you can do that. So that is 2 divided by 30 and so on. Right? So how much proportion they are making out of the total data set. So that you can do that. And in cumulative proportion, you can take this number right here, and here we start. So we can take this number plus a previous number. So cumulative proportion bhi hum iska bana sakte hain. When you drag it down, it will keep on adding all those numbers, right? So yeah, so this number plus this number, previous cumulative result plus next one. So when you move up till here, it keep on adding all those proportion. Finally over here it's 1. So up to 9 minutes late, these are the buses which are 1 to 10 minutes late. Some are 1 minute late, some are 2 minutes maximum. There are 2 buses that were late, like 10 minutes. So up to 10 minutes late are all of them. How many are 2 minutes are below? They are 2 of them that are 1 minute late and 3 of them that are 2 minutes late. So 2 are below are 5 of them. So that 5 makes up 0.16 of. So that is this proportion plus this one. You add up actually and so on up till you reach here. And then percentage, you can also calculate it, right? So this divided by, you can do that by yourself as well. So that is the total ka ye kitne ban raha hai, or cumulative percentage, you can do that. Now we want to draw this thing, and you go here insert, and here you go with this bar chart thing. And now I just plainly inserted that, and luckily my numbers are the same which actually I wanted here, but actually it goes with the series consecutive order 1 2 3 4. You draw any graph, it will make like this. Okay, actually here we set this also. Let's just do it for the second one, for the second group where I made the 5 bins. But if it is not like that, here you can put the title yourself. For example, the bus late arrivals in minutes or whatever, jo bhi aap iska heading karna chahe. Okay, you can make this graph bigger. Is it a bar chart or a histogram?
Bar plot.
Bar chart.
Bar chart.
Yeah, so how can you make a histogram? You can touch those bars. So acha, here you can add those data labels as well. So those labels, these numbers, they can come over here. So 1 minute late or 2 minutes late or 3. That what do you think, this data is normal? I feel like this data is normal, the distribution is normal.
No.
Yeah, skewed. Is it skewed? Seems like it. Seems like it.
Yes.
So this is how the shape looks like, but obviously we can go and do this complete with the data analysis toolkit. We can get the descriptives and we can see those parameters, and then we can decide the shape or normality of this distribution, right? So shape is not the only criteria, but we can apply the other tests as well. Jinoman, are we going beyond 4 o'clock or?
Ji sir, ja sakte hain. Maine wo extend kar diya time.
Okay. Students, participants, comments le lete hain. How far we are going, or maybe if they are saturated, then we can come again in next week. Continue from here with the same people. We don't announce the second phase of it, the Jamovi, so we can further extend that to the next week as well. Okay, or maybe we can give them the homework and then they can do that and bring it back, and then we can proceed further. All right, so ye ho gaya, aur ek aur cheez kya isme se hum ye jo gap width, you double click here this thing on the bars and you will get this thing, format data point. Over here it's called gap width. When you decrease that, the things, the bars, they start touching. So now you get a histogram. You get a histogram. This is a bar chart. Further, you can reduce them, right? and you can increase their distance 500%. The total default pe distance given hai. No distance, 0%. They are touching. Now it's a histogram. Should we take it as a histogram or should we take it as a bar chart? What are your thoughts? These numbers are continuous or these numbers are categories like males, females, right? People coming from different ethnic groups or people coming from different nationalities or, you know, genders. What should we do? Let's leave it like a bar chart or should we make an histogram out of it? So continuous numbers or continuous data, better we should represent it with histograms. So that's what you do, okay? All right. Actually, here is another data called as cruise data. So we have three ships and these are the ages of different people going on these ships. I'm not going into it, but let me take one of them like this Santa Maria. And let me show you real quick this, how we can do this various thing. How can we calculate variance manually? Kaise hum nikal sakte? I think you guys can make use of all those functions and calculate all those things which are down here. Maybe you can practice and all those things which are here. Again, we already did that. So here I want to get the square of some number. So this is the number right now I'm targeting, this one, the neighbor over here. And this is the X, and I can take the square of this. So I can go simply click this number. And this thing is, this symbol is called as caret. It's there on your keyboard. Press shift and you press 6, 6. So this six, digit six, has a caret sign on it. You know caret? In our times, we have a cartoon, Bugs Bunny used to eat a caret. The caret has a top part which he throws on, you know, after eating that, and you also throw that. So top part of a caret looks like this. So this symbol over here is caret. Ye wala. All right. So yeah. So this caret is here. Yeah. So we can go this and D2 equal to D2, and we press shift and caret, and you put 2. If you put 2, it will give you square. If you put 3 after the caret, that will give you the cube. Right? So that's what you can do that. And you drag it down up till here. So these are all squares, sum of squares, sum of these numbers and their squares. You can get their deviations from their X bar or the mean. And what is the mean or X bar over here? I can do it here for this distribution. So for this Santa Maria, these are three cruise ships and these are the ages of the people who are going on these cruise ships. And I want you to suggest me which one I should take it for myself, which one you're gonna take it and which one someone else should take it. So these are the ages, the age data, and these are the three. You know, three samples from these three ships, and populations which are underlying are everyone who travels on all these ships, right, from beginning till now. That's the population in question. So while looking into this sample, we can infer that ki Nina pe, which age groups they generally go on Nina, which go on Pinta, which go on Santa Maria. I need to take the cruise and you need to take the cruise ship, and I want to send Sophia. She is my daughter. She is 7 years of age. So we can decide based upon this analysis that which ship we can take it, right? So D2 to D13. And these are our numbers. And I want to, I'm sorry, have the average or mean. So the mean or age over here is 41. In Nina, it's 41, right? I can do that here as well. Average age of the numbers up till here. So where is that? Come on, Gary. Yeah, so I can simply apply it to the next one. So it will automatically apply it on C, which is the next one. So average age here is 20, here is 29, here is 41. Which one I gonna, I should pick? Which ship I should pick? Suggest me one. Average age is 41. And which one you gonna pick, guys?
10.
Average age on Nena is 20, and Pinta is 29, and Santa Maria is 41. And we are just looking for the means. We are not looking for anything else. So you pick up one. Which one you gonna pick up?
Pinta.
That's probably your age group. Okay, and this one has slightly more age, but the actual numbers are smaller. So probably these are the kindergartners, and probably these are their teachers, right? And probably there is a grandma here as well.
I'm in the middle of a class, guys.
So if you have brought some friends also. Lights off, Kapi. Anyway, so we can get the deviation. So this number minus this and so on. And I can apply it to rest of them, all those deviations. Right. And then I can sum all these numbers, sum of those deviations. So the function is sum. That's what I can do. And sum of these numbers which are here. 451. I said it should be 0. Oops. I screwed up somewhere, right? So this is D2 minus H2. This is D3 minus H3. That's what we want. This is, we look here whether our function is working fine or it's screwed up. It seems like it's screwed up, right? So it is D4 minus H4, which is a blank cell, empty cell. So finally, your answer is the same as 39. That we don't want. We actually want to fix this thing. But here, we actually do something over here. And we don't want to change its rows. So maybe we can give him a dollar sign here. Let's see if it works. Right. And now we do that. Yeah. And now the sum is equal to 0. That's fine. It fixed that. It fixes that. Everything here, Microsoft products, they need dollars. Right, a lot of dollars. That's why they are so rich. Anyways, so sum of the deviations is equal to 0, but I say we should take the square of those deviations. So sum of, then sum of squares in the end we would take it. So F2 ka square minus 2 is 4 and so on. And now we apply this sum. We can simply drag it. And when once we drag it, obviously our reference also changes, but that's what we want. We are fine with it. If you do not want to change the column, you can also give him a dollar sign, but here you can give the dollar not between these two, H and dollar two, you will write dollar H2, okay? You can fix both rows and columns. In that case, you can give him $2, $1 here, $1 here, right? That's why you can fix that. But again, Excel has a lot of issues, so we use it for teaching purposes, but for real fun, we go with the other softwares where our effort is less. You are entering the data manually. You are entering the functions yourself all the time. Rather than that, they should be built in and you should click some buttons, right? So everything is coded. So in that case, you may be surely reducing the chances of error. Chances of doing mistakes, right? Again, I want to know about, acha ji, humne decide kiye the ships. So I want to know about a real quick reference. We forgot one thing. Sum of the square deviations is 32. Now I want the variance, and then I want a standard deviation. So what is the variance? Sum of those square deviations divided by N, if it's a population, if it's sample n minus 1, what do you think these are? Are these samples or are these populations? So where n is equal to, I can count them, but I can
samples. See
13 minus 1. So these are samples. So the 12 numbers are here, so we divide it by 11, not with the 12. So that's our variance. And for standard deviation, we can take this number, and there is a function called as square root. So we can apply this square root thing over here, right? So variance and std is standard. Achha, by the way, you might be interested in another thing, which is there. Standard error. What is that? Standard error is not here in Excel, but we calculate it as, I can write it as std dot error. The standard error is, any question here? Standard deviation.
Mostly,
people are quitting.
Sir, mostly, yes, sir. So,
okay. No worries.
Next time either se karega join kar le.
Stop right here. So standard error is this number V16 divided by square root of take their comments and feedback as well. N square root of 12. So that's your standard error. So how can you plot mean and standard errors? We can also have a graph or a plot where you can have mean and standard error, so that we can do it next time. How much strength left, Noman?
I guess 50, around about 50.
So how many total they attended? And I think I can stop right here and maybe you can take some comments or questions or concerns. Feel free to give Noman the feedback. Maybe you can generate a feedback on like this Google Forms, and you can get it. And maybe you can put another question over there if they are interested in, you know, what parts they are more interested in. Like, for example, what should we cover more? Like those statistical tests, hypothesis testing, etc. I'm sorry, I had to cover some background for you guys. I thought that is important. And I see some international students here. Hafiz Usmanov. Hafiz Usmanov, you hear us, brother? You're from Azerbaijan. Hafiz Usmanov. Maybe you can allow the audience to unmute their mics. Ji?
Salam alaikum.
Alaikum assalam. Glad to see you, brother.
MashaAllah, very good.
Oh, thank you so much. You are in which city of Azerbaijan?
Yes, Azerbaijan Medical University.
Very nice. Which city? Baku?
Yes, Baku, biochemistry department.
MashaAllah, MashaAllah. We had professors from Azerbaijan in our university, COMSATs. In fact, three of them. One was art department professor. Yeah, Professor Ilham Shahmuradov. He was there.
Yes, Shahmuradov, yes.
You know him?
He is worked in biotechnology institute. This is in Baku.
Very interesting. Interesting. And then the brother Yashar Salmanov, he was there. And brother Mai, I think brother Mai settled in Islamabad. He liked Islamabad.
Sorry.
Brother Mai, he's still here.
Lazım.
You hear us?
Görmüş, oradan sonra ulaşırım gelende.